Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
Britain has now joined much of mainland Europe in shutting down everyday life, although it's still behind countries like France, Spain and Italy. Late on Friday afternoon, the British Prime Minister Boris Johnson ordered all pubs, restaurants and leisure facilities to close after people had ignored requests to stay away voluntarily. Bar owner Roy van der Wiel described the swift reaction to the new measures.
As the Prime Minister came off the TV, we had probably about 10, 15 phone calls that cancelled table bookings, buffets, dinners and everything, really. So it was sort of quite shocked it happened so quick.
Our reporter Stephanie Prentice has been out and about to get a sense of what life is like in Britain today.
I'm standing on Oxford Street in central London.
All pubs, restaurants, everyday life.
Carries out over a number of months so that we can cope with it. And the governor of New York said we are talking about a number of months. This is not going to be a number of weeks.
Barbara Platt-Usher in Washington. Britain has now joined much of mainland Europe in shutting down everyday life, although it's still behind countries like France, Spain and Italy. Late on Friday afternoon, the British Prime Minister Boris Johnson ordered all pubs, restaurants and leisure facilities to close after people had ignored requests to stay away voluntarily. Bar owner Roy van der Wiel described the swift reaction to the new measures.
As the Prime Minister came off the TV, we had probably about 10, 15 phone calls that cancelled table bookings, buffets, dinners and everything, really. So it was sort of quite shocked it happened so quick.
Our reporter Stephanie Prentice has been out and about to get a sense of what life is like in Britain today.
I'm standing on Oxford Street in central London, usually one of the busiest shopping streets in the world. On a bright sunny Saturday, it would be crammed with people shopping, eating, drinking, sitting outside. Today, walking up and down it, it's almost completely deserted. There's one coffee chain open, one pharmacy, and apart from that, all the shops have their shutters down. There's very little traffic. The people I have seen on the streets aren't shopping. They seem to be walking quickly from one place to another. A lot of them are wearing masks and a lot of them are wearing gloves. Some of the people I've seen even seem to be cautious about walking too close to each other. I've seen people avoiding each other. Usually around 500,000 people come through here daily. Even last weekend, it was fairly busy, and today the situation has completely changed. This almost deserted street is a reflection of the situation unfolding across the capital as Prime Minister Boris Johnson advises people to avoid social contact. Just down the road from where I'm standing, famous tourist destinations like Leicester Square and Trafalgar Square are also extremely quiet. There still seem to be a few tourists milling around, but mostly the pavements, benches and monuments are deserted.
Stephanie Prentice. Oliver Conway asked our political correspondent Rob Watson about the thinking behind the government's latest plans.
I think there are three things, really, Oliver. I think the first is that the British government would already consider these measures pretty draconian. I think the second is that the government wants to leave room for more tightening if that's needed. And I think thirdly, Prime Minister Boris Johnson, he's got libertarian instincts. I think he finds all of this incredibly difficult, getting the government to tell people what to do.
So give us a sense of what life is likely to be like until these restrictions are lifted and how long that could be.
Well, I think our colleague Stephanie was incredibly eloquent in describing one aspect of it. That's just that the first one is the way in which Britain just looks different. I mean, you just go anywhere and it's deserted. This is a rich country where people love the service industry. People love going out, buying stuff, going to bars. So all of that is gone, so it looks different. I think the second element is what you might call the sort of societal emotional one, where people are at home with each other and goodness only knows how they're all getting on with each other, Oliver. And then the third one is the economic effect. I mean, this is nothing has been seen like this, never mind peacetime, in wartime, where the government has actually just closed down vast chunks of the economy with who knows what consequences in the short, medium and long term.
And what are we expecting from the government next? They're going to review this every month?
Yes, they're going to review these arrangements on a monthly basis, the level level of the isolation. But I think if you had to say what is the government going to do in the next few days, I would see, number one, sort out the practical details of these economic rescue plan that they announced, and just keep their fingers crossed that this isolation will stop the National Health Service from going under.
Rob Watson.
Context of white supremacy. Gus T Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Sunday, March 22, 2020, so I have been told. We will be here tomorrow. We have captive audiences around the world. Large numbers of folks are on lockdown, under quarantine, and all the rest. So, since we have folks who are not able to do too much traveling, we will just keep right on broadcasting. We still have the problem that we are attempting to solve. We'll be here tomorrow. That's Monday, March 23. White woman, the problem. White woman will be our guest. We'll be talking about the new book, The Poisoned City, which is about the Flint, Michigan water crisis, which is interesting because now that we've got this whole Chinese virus pandemic, the folks in Michigan have said, hey, water for all, human rights, which is what they had been saying for years. Oh, no. You got to pay your water bill. Turn that off. Even if you owe us, $100, you got to pay your bill. Now it's bad. Got a crisis. Forget all that. Again, super important. White people could practice justice immediately if they wanted to. They like it the way it is on the plantation. Anyway, this is the triumphant return of our Global Sunday Talk on racism. We have not had this broadcast in some time. 2019 was brutal. Really, every year is. We'll all be saying 2020 was brutal. But it just disrupted my broadcasting schedule. Half of the year I was still displaced with the flood, and it was just difficult getting back totally on schedule and getting this broadcast back specifically. But we had so many people who nagged me, and Gus, where's the Global Sunday Talk? That's really important, and I miss hearing from different listeners in different parts of the world. It is a bit sad that the context that brought this program back, but wow. Any other time throughout the years of our broadcast existence where we have talked about racism, white supremacy is a global problem, a global system, and the importance of non-white people, victims of racism, exchanging views, talking to each other around the world so we can contrast, compare how this system operates and get better, get stronger, see, wow, white people do a lot of the same things worldwide in mistreating black people, mistreating non-white people. These days, the response has been so different depending on where you are. We heard a clip from the BBC at the beginning. They just began like the mandatory closings and things of that nature over the past 24 hours or so. Other locations have been doing that for some time. It just really depends on where you are on the globe in terms of what the response is right now. But there is a response of some sort with this measure, historic times. Just really thankful that we have this as a resource where people can share information and hopefully get some constructive information to help them make sense of the confusion and figure out constructive, logical steps to take in these confusing times. Wowie, I will try to hush my mouth so we can just hear from people from different parts of the world. We had a number of folks who emailed in, some of the normal people who participate in this program, who are not able to be with us. So I'm going to see if I can share all of their emails as we go. I won't do them all at the beginning. I'll disperse them as we go. We even have a Cows listener in China. I was trying desperately to see if we could get them on live. I think the time in China right now is actually 5 a.m. Monday morning. So, it's quite a sacrifice to get up that early for Cows listeners on a Monday morning where this person has work. But He did email in, and we are going to see if we can get him on the program live to give some thoughts. But he did share. He was in China during the quarantine and had some very interesting perspectives on all this. I'll read his commentary as well. But our opening email from Mary, she's in the UK. She's been with us on this Global Talk many times. She writes in, not able to join us because she had prior commitments. But she said that she hopes that we're able to remain sane. She had a couple of notes. Number one, they are determined to apply a black face to the virus. Idris Elba, UK actor, in black male, NBA players, UK football players, but it's not somewhat not taking hold as the recovery is too quick and it isn't fatal to us yet. Number two, the dismay that Africans in Africa aren't being ravaged. It's been outsiders spreading it there. Africa needs to close its borders. One of the reports that I played yesterday, many of the countries are starting to do that and saying, nope, no traveling. Get out of here. You can't come. Number three, they will refine the virus to make it deadly to blacks when contracted. Number four, I've noticed a concerted effort by whites to remain dirty and practice deplorable hygiene, coughing near me, standing near me when unnecessary. My God, social. They were talking about fines for that sort of thing in some regions, like getting breaking the social distancing norms and what have you. Like, man, back up. It would be big time. Black self-respect in personal space. Back up. Give me 5 feet. Number six, what they just had that report too about white supremacists saying that they were trying to deliberately spread the coronavirus too. We talked about that yesterday. Number six, whites in the U.S. stocking up on guns and bullets whilst largely we try to get food, demonstrating the extreme lack of preparedness. In the meantime, please take care, stay indoors more now than ever before. Meditate so you do not fall down with depression and try your very best to eat well, eat well, eat well. Much obliged from Mary. I will let's see, do I have time? I'll get in one more. Stacy in the UK also. She's been with us many, many times for workplace racism. She's with us a lot of times, even if she does not talk, and workplace racism generally airs live at 1 a.m. London time, and she is hanging right in, sharing frequently, contributing her own situations and suggestions. She's not able to be with us today, but she wrote in a couple of observations from the UK reaction to the coronavirus. Number one, the government response at the start focused on herd immunity, stating that they wanted 60% of the population to get the virus, which would have caused deaths, particularly in older generations, as we were first informed. Less than a week later, we are being told to isolate and not assume that the younger generation, who began to act as if they would not be affected, would be unaffected. This change in messaging and government policy, which includes the forced closure of bars and restaurants, has caused confusion, there's that word again, fear, panic buying, and mass job losses. For example, today's messaging from government is that there may be a need for social distancing for at least 12 months. Good gosh. Yesterday, the PM, Prime Minister, stated he expected the country to break the back of the virus in 3 months. There also seems to be panic at government level on the impact on health services. We are no longer being told about the herd immunity strategy. Number two, media coverage is also causing panic, whilst at the same time being critical of people who are panicked by what they are hearing and reading. The face of the virus is definitely changing, with more younger and non-white people being shown on broadcast. That would be two patterns. Number three, schools and other educational institutions have been closed except for children of essential workers. There was a major delay in making this decision with no clarity on how the virus affects people in the long term. This is a very strange decision, particularly given the current change in messaging on the need for social distancing. Stacy in the UK. With that, we do have other emails from some of the other folks who aren't able to join us live, but they wanted to share their thoughts. I think they're important. I'll get our listener in China as well. I will get everybody. Everybody will have a chance to ask a question if you're in the States or wherever. If you have questions or observations, I will get you on the line. But we'll start with our folks who are outside the States. Wowee. We have been on. I'll just get this in quick. Folks did not call in for this broadcast to hear from Gus T. When we started this broadcast, or we were able to get back on the air in 2009, Man, there is no way. If you had said, one, you'll still be broadcasting in 11 years. Two, there'll be a planetary pandemic and you will be broadcasting with people joining in live from London, Austria, South Korea, ready to participate in the program. I definitely would have laughed and said, man, oh man, you have got to be on some major serious drugs. Please share. Context of white supremacy, sobriety would be best. Global problem. Let's see. We have one of our longtime participants, Global Sunday Talk. So glad to have him back with us. I believe Andrew in the UK. Are you with us, sir? Not hearing. I'll double check, make sure I got him on correctly. Looks like he should be there. Not hearing him, though. We'll try again. In the meantime, let's see. Joining us live from Austria, African 1884. Are you with us?
Yes, I am. Can I be heard?
Crystal clear. So good to hear from you, sir. Let's see. You are in Austria. I'm not even familiar. What's the status? Are you all on quarantine or lockdown? What's the status in Austria?
Yes, so we've been on lockdown. It's been now about a week, and this lockdown is going to last until the 13th of April. It could be extended, depending on how the government sees it can deal with the coronavirus. The only things that are in operation, the only services, are supermarkets and pharmacies. The hospitals, they're encouraging people not to go there. If you just have any random fever or sneeze and everything, you have to be really, really 100% sure that it's like that the symptoms are for the coronavirus. So for the most part, hospitals are being closed off too. And if you have anyone that's in hospital that's been admitted there, you just get information via phone call or via email. The public transport is still moving. The supermarkets are stocked up. The only thing that's really going out of, like, that's really been bought a lot is toilet paper, and I wonder why. I mean, it's they're rationing out toilet paper, but otherwise, all the food products, sugar, rice, anything, other food products are already readily available in the supermarkets, and the government has been making broadcasts on TV and telling people not to worry, not to buy things in bulks, that they have enough supplies and everything. So that's the status right now. Yeah, and we're just trying to stay in for the most part. I spend most of the time with my wife and my child. I got a newborn baby in December 16th last year. So his name is Niall. He's 3 months old. So I'm just staying in him, my wife, and just the three of us and everything. I only tend to go out just to do the grocery shopping, and that's it. Otherwise, we've been told not to go out if it's not necessary.
Wow, congratulations. Being a new attempted father, safety for all. Now, that was something that I was talking about, attempted parents. I guess, number one, how fearful are you? Do you think that this is something that, you know, could be a problem for you, your family? And then as an attempted parent, what protocols are you taking for your child, if any, to make sure that your child stays safe?
I mean, regarding my child, we are trying very much not to have him around, you know, using the public transport, you know, so we want him not to have be in contact and get any sickness, because again, like I said, if you go to the hospital, then you end up going in with something different. Then you walk out with the coronavirus. You know, that's what people are being told. You know, so it's best to just try and stay home as much as possible. The family, in terms of if I'm fearful for the whole thing, I mean, in terms of work, yes, because where I work, there was an idea from HR, human resources, they were suggesting that during the lockdown that people should get fired so that the company does not spend money on paying people. And then once the lockdown is finished, then we could get rehired again, you know. So that means if the lockdown is for 1 month or 2 months, that means you don't have any salary, you know. Luckily enough, there was a pushback from top management, and so we're trying to work from home, and we're still getting paid. You know, so the only thing that I'm worrying about is my source of income. And other than that, even if you're self-employed, for the most part, if you own a barbershop, if you own a restaurant, all that is shut down. You know, so for the people who are self-employed, they have so much secure, you know, previously, but now people are struggling in the sense that there's no business, they can't run any business, you know. So those who are hired and have a full-time contract are much more secure in this process, in this particular period and everything, you know. And for myself right now, I'm glad that I have a contract until the end of the year, and there was pushback from top management, so my salary will continue coming, you know. So that's only fear I have. Otherwise, in terms of food, water, and everything, I feel like the Austrian state has got the hang of it. The white supremacists here are very well organized, so it should be okay, you know. And don't forget that we have a very small population of black people here, so it's not like the dynamics aren't like in the UK or in the US. So I would see to it, like, maybe, for example, in the US, where you'd have the white supremacists saying, okay, you know what, the white trash having to fight for food supplies and start saying, okay, let's barricade certain spaces off for non-white people that shouldn't come here and all that and eat with us or shop with us. Nah, I don't think it can get that bad, because we're a very small minority. We're a very small minority. So, I mean, I hope it doesn't get that bad, you know. So, yeah.
That is something very interesting to be mindful of, kind of paying attention to the countries that have a very low population of black people and what their response. We have people in Canada and other people in South Korea that have a low population of black people, what their response has been. To countries that have a higher population of black people, what their response is. That can just be something to be mindful of. Let's see. Much obliged for sharing. Let me see if I can bring in some of our other folks who are with us globally, and then we'll circle back, hear what African 1884, others will take callers as well. Let's see, I think our caller in South Korea, who's been with us several times before, has even participated in workplace racism. Are you with us, sir? Caller in South Korea?
Can I be heard?
Crystal clear. So glad to hear from you.
How you doing, guest?
Right poorly.
Likewise. Well, it's obligatory time check. It's Monday, 4:22 a.m. So I just woke up. So if I sound a little sleepy, that's why. Let's see. The vibe here in South Korea is just, I live in Daegu, so it's the epicenter of the outbreak in South Korea. So I think when it started happening around February 19th, my mom, she was really concerned, so she kept calling me. I think because the American media was hyping it up so much, but actually down here the vibe was, it was pretty calm. There were a lot of supplies in the grocery store. It wasn't too hectic. The government sends us text messages every day to our phone. So once I translate the messages, it just says things like, stay inside, wash your hands, stop coughing in the open air, wear a mask, and things like that. Other than that, it's not too bad. I'm just really trying not to catch it, because I feel like, being a black person, if I show up to the hospital versus the Koreans, I might not receive treatment as quickly as they would. Koreans tend to take care of their own first, and then everyone else. So other than that, I've just been staying inside, reading books, drawing, playing video games. Right now I'm reading AIDS, Opium, Diamonds, and Empire. But other than that, no, it's fine. I'm doing well. I hope you're doing well, too.
Nancy Turner Banks, she was a guest on The Cows a couple times, actually. AIDS, Opium, Diamonds, and Empire, right on my bookshelf here. So thankful for you sacrificing some of your rest. You could have been sleeping and doing other things. That is an enormous point about the anti-blackness, and if you get sick, how you would be treated and what resources would be made available to you. Did you consider leaving at any point? Like, man, maybe I should, you know, head back to the States or get out of here?
I sure did. I had a number in my head that I was going to go back to the States at. But then when I saw the numbers rising in the States, I said, maybe I should just stay here, because it didn't seem like America was taking it as seriously as South Korea. I mean, in South Korea, every single person outside has a mask on. But when I look at America, you know, people are buying up toilet paper and don't have on masks. And I'm like, what is going on? It doesn't seem organized at all. Here in South Korea, you can go through a drive-through or a walk-through and just get a test and have the results back in 6 hours. It should be like $100. Where I know in America, it's a little bit more difficult to get a test and things like that. So I just feel like it's more organized here. And also, my parents are over 60, so I really didn't want to be asymptomatic and then, you know, maybe go home and infect them unknowingly and things like that. So I just chose to stay here.
Logical. Wow. That is super interesting. The efficiency and that's what I've been pointing out here and saying, because it seems so slipshod, especially with things like the schools, where I pointed out that they didn't have like a national policy about schools. Like sometimes it would be county by county, they would have different policies. Sometimes it would be a statewide policy. Just, you know, that does not seem like the best way. If this is a serious pandemic, it would just be, hey, all the public schools K-12 are going to be shut down. Boom. Like, have you paid attention? Well, like, what's the status of the schools over there?
Yeah, I'm an English teacher here. So the mandate came from the federal government level. So you just said no more school until April 6th. And that's for the entirety of Korea. And some exceptions like Jeju Island, they're not in school, right? I mean, they have school right now because they're so far away and they only have a few cases. But other than that, everything comes from a national level.
Betsy DeVos, we have a Secretary of Education, CDC, Surgeon General. Felt like it could have been lots of folks who could have came out and done something similar. Maybe I'm being ignorant. Let me see. We have much obliged our caller in South Korea. Let me bring in some of our other folks from around the world, just so everybody can kind of share their opening salvo. And then if you all have suggestions or other observations that you would like to share, if our listeners have any questions that they want to ask some of you all that are around the globe, we'll make time for that as well. Let's see. Be in Toronto. I just saw on CBC where they were talking about considering criminal penalties if you violate the self-imposed doing things like what Mary talked about, going up to people and coughing on them and getting real close on them and rubbing on them and things like that. They were considering, this is in Canada, they were considering criminal penalties for that sort of behavior. Be in Toronto, should be with us.
Hi, greetings, guests, callers, and listeners. Yes, you are correct. There was a situation in Quebec, which is the province, just one province east of Ontario, where I'm in. And there was a woman that was diagnosed with the COVID-19, and neighbors were aware. And she did breach the self-imposed self-isolation that was recommended by the health the health officials who treated her, and the neighbors called it in and said that she was out and about, and she was arrested and brought to a medical facility where she's currently being quarantined as a result. So in that case, yes. There has been criminal charges imposed along with fines as a result. Now, keep in mind, this is in particular a context where the neighbors already knew about it. The situation is that the health information or privacy of health information For those who have been diagnosed, if they haven't notified other people around, and not many people know about their circumstances because they do not have to give that information, it is considered confidential. They could be out and about diagnosed, and we would not know. So it's just by happenstance that, you know, the neighbors knew, and she's spoken to enough people, and she got charged as a result of breaching that. I know that in Ontario, on Thursday when I sent the email, amount went from 257 and then it bumped up to 258 cases. Now it currently stands at 318, and that's mainly due to screening in terms of persons affected. They have initiated the social distancing and are advocating it. I know that Premier Trudeau had done another live address, his seventh one to date, in which it's been outlined that Nova Scotia is the final province that has now instituted a state of emergency. So at this time, all provinces within Canada are now under a state of emergency. For Ontario, they had that you cannot congregate with no more than 50 people, so it has to be 50 people or under. And also, in terms of social distancing, you have to be 2 meters away from the next individual or 6 feet to prevent any droplets to come into contact with you. Unlike the measles, where it hangs on to dust particles and can hang around suspended in air for a certain period of time, up to 2 hours, for the coronavirus, health officials are saying that that is not the case. They only survive on the droplets. The droplets, once they suspend into the air, immediately drops onto the floor or onto a surface contact or onto the next person if they are shorter than 2 meters or 6 feet. Now, in terms of how feasible this is to implement, it's very difficult to implement this type of thing. There are people who are still congregating in parks, beaches, different public venues, hence the reason why the state of emergency has been put into place, because the government felt and the health officials felt that Canadian citizens weren't taking it as serious as it should be. I know that in Nova Scotia, you cannot congregate with no more than 5 persons. So it has to be 5 persons or less. And the same with the 2 meters distance between each person. In terms of occupations, there are different types of occupations that this will not be effective. I know that, for instance, the schools, they have closed it down until April 5th or 6th. In Ontario, there's what's known as the Section 23 classes, as well as there's treatment programs called TRIAD, where you have high behavioral children and youth who would require additional support because they tend to elope or run off or just have high aggressive behaviors. So in these situations, it's impossible to have a social distancing of 2 meters or 6 feet. And if that youth happens to be sick, if they're at home and the parents are not getting the support, that makes it even more difficult. Same with group homes, same with retirement homes, same with shelters. I mean, it's just really hard to keep this measure. The toilet paper situation has been running out in many places. There's also been shelves that are completely empty in terms of paper towels, water,
and other staple items. One thing was reported was that Kraft dinner is going to be more placed on the shelves. Not that it's a good product anyway. It's processed and not healthy. So my offspring does relay that message for everyone to stay healthy as well. Eat right. Make sure you're getting the appropriate sleep so that it helps to boost the immune system. Be sure to exercise as well, even if it's at least 30 minutes a day. Exercise to break a sweat. Again, that's going to help with boosting the immune system. People have been getting masks. The N95 mask is the most appropriate for this situation because, similar to that, there was a SARS situation outbreak in Toronto many years back, and the N95 mask is the best one. However, people have been using surgical masks that are not effective. They've also gone to get construction masks that are not effective. For the gloves, they're saying that they're not effective as well, even though I've been hearing many people using the gloves. Many of the walk-in clinics have shut down as a result of the COVID-19. Hospitals are also saying the same thing of if it's not an emergency, please refrain from coming to the hospital. What other stuff? They're also saying that in terms of those who are being laid off from work due to it, they're recognizing that people are having difficulty paying their mortgages and their rent. So Parliament is to reconvene, hopefully by Monday, in order to get the bills passed in order to provide some sort of financial compensation. For those who are contracted with the COVID-19 virus, they can go on an employment insurance. I know for Ontario, there's usually a two-week delay or grace period until the benefits kick in. That has been reduced to 1 week. And yeah, it's just pretty taxing and difficult on everyone here. In light of this, they're just sending out different information that can be confusing in terms of the symptoms. I know that for Ontario telehealth, which was to be the buffer system between people just going directly to the emergency department at the hospital. The Ontario telehealth was to be that buffer system, which will have nurses on the telephone to go and help diagnose certain situations and make recommendations, or at least not necessarily diagnose, but at least make medical recommendations for those calling in as to what to do for the next steps. Ontario telehealth has been having a flooding of calls, so that hasn't been able to work as properly as well. So yeah, those have been the main things, and I leave the line.
Wow. Much obliged for the report. Be in Toronto. Just kind of where she began with her report about possible criminal penalties. If you violate the quarantine, or in this instance, she was talking about this woman who had the virus and then she left and her neighbors reported her. Now imagine, black person, and you're out, you cough, sneeze, anything like that. Maybe you don't even have the virus. You just, you know, leave the house or something. And normal circumstances, the way black people have a difficult time moving through public space. Much obliged to be in Toronto. Number again is 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-#. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Anybody that's listening in, if you're in the States or not, if you have a question or observations, whatever it is, press star 61 and I can get to your hand. Let's see if we have any other international folks. Let's see. Our other caller in Canada, did you have any observations that you wanted to share, sir?
Hello, Gus, the host and the cow listeners. I'm just trying to learn how to meditate. You know, well, I do know how to meditate. So one of the things that I do to keep myself relaxed, it's called the 4-7-8 breath. So you sit down or you lie down and you breathe in through your nose for 4 seconds. And then you imagine the air coming up from the tip of your toes, through your legs, to your chest, all the way to the top of your head. And then you hold your breath in for 7 seconds. And then you imagine the breath going to the top of your head, all the way down to your shoulders, down to your feet. And then you breathe out for 8 seconds. Imagine the breath coming all the way from the tip of your toes, all the way to the top of your head. And then you just concentrate on breathing. It's a form of mental relaxation. It keeps you focused on the here and now. In this time when people are, you know, anxious, worried, you know, they're concerned, I believe the media has been really irresponsible. You know, they're just creating a lot of fear mongering. Instead of just trying to keep people focused on the here and now, they're making them worried about things that they don't really have any control over. I mean, just simply washing your hands, being kind to others, helping others, paying attention to the here and now. That's just one way of, you know, doing something constructive that could benefit yourself and benefit others. So that's basically what I'm doing, you know. I'm also looking at what non-white people are doing all over the world, you know, and hoping that they're thinking about how to do constructive things, being constructive problem solvers. And that's really what the compensatory code is really all about. Thank you. I'll mute my line.
Much obliged, good sir. Little meditation. Awesome. B was talking about that as well. Get some exercise in, get some breathing in. That can be extremely helpful in these times filled with anxiety and stress. Exercise, meditate, breathe. Number again, 605-313-5164. The code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Before I get some of the other folks who dialed in with questions, as I said, we had one of our listeners in China. He wrote in, had quite a bit to say about the situation over there, the epicenter. It came from China, says our president. Our listener, he writes in, I'm sorry I was not able to speak with you earlier. A few things came up related to work. Isn't that always the case? As I mentioned to you by Facebook message, I am a black male living and working in China. Since the beginning of the coronavirus outbreak, I have remained in China. Family and friends in the U.S. were frantically begging me to come home. After careful consideration, I remained because several foreign colleagues at my university packed up and returned to their respective countries. This left quite a void, as one would expect. And by the time the virus had reached its height, I made up my mind that it could possibly be worse for me to leave, and I was also in constant correspondence with many of my grad and undergrad students. It felt wrong for me to leave because they could not leave, my Chinese colleagues could not leave, and I felt a bit of duty to wait this out, and I now believe I made the correct choice. Having got that personal side of why I stayed out of the way, I would like to discuss my quarantine here in China, my experiences avoided this pandemic, and why I feel black people in America are at a greater risk of infection of COVID-19 than other races in the United States. That is one thing. There's only one race in the system of racism, white supremacy, the white race. I also want to share information on how black people in the United States can minimize the risk of infection based on effective countermeasures I undertook, both through self-imposed and government-imposed. The quarantine. January 29. Everyone across the country has been notified about this new virus that is spreading throughout this epicenter, Wuhan City in Hubei province. At this time, I began to start receiving messages and calls from deans of my university informing me of the situation and guidelines at the time with future ones to become to begin. Within a week of the virus was spreading throughout the country, a quarantine order was given. We were allowed to go out of our homes every 2 days, and our GPS location services were ordered to be on to monitor where we went. Maybe the first such use of this technology to two massive tracking of people in the history of such technology. I was not keen of this type of power wielded over me, but I began to see this as not such a bad idea considering the swiftness of the virus's spread across the country. I only went out for supplies, and in each store I went to, everyone had their temperature taken before they could enter. Of course, there were shortages of food stocks, and there were reports of fighting and public disorder, but very rare considering the situation. After returning to my home, I was met by security guards who would also take my temperature, and I was required to tell the guards where I went and sign my name on a ledger to confirm my whereabouts. I also gave them a ticket, which I received, that proved I was only going out every 48 hours. Failure to provide said ticket would prevent me from entering and a prompt to call police. I never violated this rule, and for the most part, it was only a mild disruption of my normal lifestyle. The racism. Across China, in the beginning of the outbreak, social media was buzzing about the possible origin of the virus. The usual suspects were the usual suspects. Rumors began to spread, no pun intended, about whether or not an African student was the cause of all the misery. Wuhan has more African university students than any other city in the country, but also all international students regardless of their country. This bigotry caused a lot of stress for African students in Wuhan, with some shops denying entry to them. This happened before. I think this happened with Ebola. I have to double check to be sure, but I'm real sure this happened with Ebola, particularly in some of these Asian, so-called Asian countries and other areas where they were denying them access. I have to double check. Go back about 2014 or so. Anyway, it took a government order to prevent such behavior, and eventually the government began to delete the posts and warn people of possible jail time for spreading such rumors. Ironically, more white people were infected with the virus than black people, and a simple search on the government's epidemic social media account would have shown this. However, racism is not logical, so to be expected. Didn't hear any reports of white people being denied entry into supermarkets or facing such discrimination. And I remembered a video I saw showing one white man from England saying how he stands with the Wuhan people and how two of his adult English students were probably apologetic for the troubles he had gone through. I will try to find that video and send it to you. One bright note is that several Chinese people replied to the video angry that these two adults apologized to him. I received no such apology or special treatment. And as far as professional standing, I am a semi-tenured professor lecturing in international relations, which is very difficult to do in China, and this white man was a 20-something English teacher working at a private English school. Normally, such people are not held in high regard in China. However, I guess his white skin was the equalizer. Not necessarily white skin, but scratch that, not an equalizer, but a cheat code to prestige. I will stop here just so we can get in some of the questions, but he has a little bit more suggestions to give out and what he thinks could be dangerous for black people in America. But I'll make sure we get the other portion in at the or before we go off the air. Let's see, getting to or before I get to any of our callers with questions, any of our international folks, anything else you wanted to add, suggestions, observations before I get to our callers, African 1884 be in Toronto, our caller in South Korea.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir. Caller in South Korea.
Yeah, I just want to second that anti-blackness sentiment amongst the these Asian people here in Korea and I guess in China as well. I noticed that when I do leave my residence to go to the store, I usually wear my mask, sunglasses, hat, but you can still see my beard, you can still see my hands. And I know this is like when I'm trying to navigate the aisles of the grocery store, people are kind of like just looking at me. Once they see that I'm black, they will just veer another way. They'll tighten their mask up. They'll grab their children. It's like, I'm like, man, I thought the Asians had the disease. I'm pretty sure it wasn't black people. But the way that they act towards me, it's like it's coming from black people. Those are the sentiments that I'm getting from these Korean people. I just wanted to say that.
Wow. It's not just I got to clutch my purse. I got to tighten my mask up. Like, oh, my God. The niggers, he's got the virus. Yeah, I thought it was, they call it the Chinese virus over here. Like, yeah, what? White supremacy, racism. Be in Toronto, any of our other international folks, anything else they want to get in before we get some of our callers?
Yes. It's quite interesting that it's me from Toronto. Thank you. It's quite interesting that the face is now being changed from Chinese to a black person. The reason being that, at least from the media that I've been seeing, there's been much coverage on Europe and how the COVID-19 is ravishing through places like Italy and London, England. So it's really interesting. I haven't seen that anti-black sentiment as of yet, but I'm pretty sure that that's going to be here, or it's just going to wrap up as well. Also, what's really interesting is for travelers who are outside of Canada having difficulty coming back into Canada. I have a friend of mine who's currently in Guyana right now that cannot get on a flight and is not showing any symptoms of the COVID-19 virus. So from the latest CBC reports, they're talking about trying to, global affairs, Canadian global affairs, trying to speak with the airlines. So WestJet, Air Transit, and Sunwing are supposed to be helping with flying Canadians back to Canada, provided that they are not, they do not have the diagnosis that warrants quarantine. And if they have a diagnosis that has similar to the symptoms, then they must produce a medical certificate for clearance. Sunwing apparently is supposed to provide free flights back to Canada. Prime Minister Trudeau is also saying that there are some people that are just going to end up being stranded there. And there is no further information as to, you know, what will happen, what type of conversation they will be receiving once they return, if they've lost their job as a result of being stranded. So definitely for all travelers who are Canadian, who are abroad, to definitely register yourself onto travel.gc.ca. So that you can get the up-to-date reports as to whether or not you would be able to obtain a flight back to Canada. So again, it's travel.gc.ca. Thank you, and I leave the line.
Much obliged.
Gus.
Yes, sir.
Gus, I wanted to add something. Down here, there's a place called Parkdale Community Legal Center. They just tweeted on blog. Toronto, people all over Toronto are saying that they're not going to pay rent on October 1st. So there's a little bit of a thing where people are getting so scared, you know, and, you know, they don't have money to pay their rent. They don't have money to buy food. So they're withholding their rent. That's all that I wanted to add.
Wow. Amazing times. Context of white supremacy. Now imagine if that was black people doing that, and even how that will be responded to, you know, because it might be, hey, we're all in this together, calm down. Just amazing times that we are in on the planet, particularly, and seeing how white people administer help. Fascinating. Let me see if I can nab in some of the folks who called. Star 61, if you have questions, observations. I think this is one of our callers in the Ohio area. 0747, did you have question, comment you wanted to share?
Greetings, Gus.
Gus?
Thanks for all the callers internationally. My question is, what is Wi-Fi and connectivity service like internationally? Because I suspect this is going to be a real issue with this isolation, you know, in terms of paying bills, educationally. In the United States, it's very haphazard. Oftentimes, not consistent in terms of access for non-white people. So I just wanted to get a sense of how things are paid for or how they're done internationally.
Now that's interesting. I guess everybody can get a crack at that because it'll probably vary greatly geographically depending on where folks are. African 1884, did you want to go first? Because I think we might have missed you. Did you want to respond to the question about the Wi-Fi?
Okay, I'll respond to the Wi-Fi and then I'll get into something later on if I get time. That's okay. Regarding the Wi-Fi, well, it's been pretty slow right now as usual because, again, everyone's been told to stay indoors. So folks are spending so much time on Netflix and there's so much traffic and people have been advised to try and spend their time doing other activities other than using the internet and everything. And also at the same time, you have people working from home. Interesting thing, just to add to that, is that the government has contacted different mobile service providers to ask them to provide them with data of people's cell phone numbers so that it can be able to monitor if people are really staying indoors. Now, it has happened here in Austria. Interesting enough is that a lot of people didn't say anything against it. I guess it's because most of the folks are in fear. So they just put it out in the media and they said, you know what, we got data from this particular mobile service provider and now we're trying to see to it that people are staying indoors and that they're respecting the guidelines that the government has put forward. Yeah, but again, just regarding the internet and the Wi-Fi, it's pretty slow because of the traffic.
Okay. Is that the information that you wanted? Caller 0747, is that the info you wanted?
Well, I was also, that's very good, but also in terms of expense and cost.
Well, payments, people are being told to make most of the payments via online, via the internet. We're being advised not to, it would be better if you do online shopping. You know, they're really so much encouraging that. In terms of costs, the costs are still the same. It doesn't change much.
Do you think it's affordable?
It is affordable, yes. For the most part in Austria, it's affordable.
Okay. Let's see, our caller in South Korea, shouldn't be that different in Canada, but I guess be in Toronto if one of y'all want to take that one. Wi-Fi, I would be very curious, South Korea, but yeah, Wi-Fi, is it working, speed, and then the payment situation?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir, our caller in South Korea.
Okay, yeah, the internet speed in South Korea is one of the fastest in the world. Luckily, it hasn't slowed down. I'm hoping it doesn't because I'm spending a lot of time indoors, whether it's, you know, looking up YouTube videos or listening to the cows. So I really need my internet speed, especially for talking to my family back home because they're really, really worried. You mentioned paying the bills as well. Usually I get like a small bill in my mailbox for the energy and the gas bill, and I can just transfer that through a bank. as far as our rent payments, that hasn't ceased. You still have to pay rent and all your expenses, but it's very affordable here in South Korea. You can find rent for about $400 to $600 US per month, so it's really affordable.
Right on. Hi, this is Bee from Toronto. And so, yes, in terms of the Wi-Fi, it's still accessible. It does slow down at different periods of the day, unfortunately. And it also depends on what type of Wi-Fi access you have, depending where as well. I mean, since most people would have gotten it from the library or other places, but the libraries are also closed, so there's no more Wi-Fi access there. In terms of the speed, again, it does vary. In terms of being able to pay bills online, I personally have not had any issues with being able to pay bills online. Been able to go through, be it takes a little bit longer for it to process, but it does go through. In terms of paying bills, I know that at least in Ontario, they do have a 60-day grace period now for property taxes and other different types of taxes, as well as for the water bill and the electric bill. Parliament is to reconvene regarding a rent payment suspension, if there is going to be one, or at least a delay, as well as for mortgage payments. I know that who stands to benefit would be the banks, because apparently there's to be an $82 billion bailout for the banks again, which is quite interesting. And one quick thing that I just wanted to add, there was an article through CTV News. They were talking about the ventilators and how the medical professionals are going to determine who gets access to those ventilators. So that will be interested, because it is reminiscent of the Hurricane Katrina situation, where there was a nurse who did who whistleblowed on the situation of how doctors were determining who was going to get care versus who doesn't get care. So if the medical professionals are saying this is not at its peak as of yet. So once it does get to its peak, it'll be really interesting as to how access to medical resources is going to play out. Thanks, and I leave the line.
Much obliged. Be in Toronto. See if we can nab some of our other folks who have questions. Let's see. Red in Ohio, did you have a question for any of our international participants?
Yes, thank you for taking my call. Hello, everyone. So in Ohio, the governor, he just directed like this stay-at-home order. And last week, they had enacted or they activated the National Guard. And so it kind of seems like it's they're secretly, you know, putting things in place. And I had a conversation with other victims, like, how are they going to make people stay at home? So I guess my question is that with the other people around the world, if you do have like this lockdown or stay at home orders, have you seen anything where whites are secretly putting special forces in place to where people are outside of their homes? If they're, you know, if there's somebody else, you know, a white badge or no, that'll kind of enforce this, that policy. And I'll mute my line. Thank you.
Interesting. Boots and guns, presumably, on the ground to enforce the quarantine social distancing. Let's see. Our caller, I'll just pick folks randomly. A caller in South Korea, any evidence of a military presence to enforce social distancing and make you all behave during all of this?
No, even when it first started and we were really starting to self-quarantine, the messages from the government that I was able to translate, it said something to the effect of, please try to stay in your homes. It didn't say you must stay in your homes. So it was, technically a self-quarantine, but most people abided by it. Every time I went down to the little grocery store, I would only see a few people just grabbing groceries and going back to their apartments. I did see police walking down the street, but they weren't stopping anyone. They were just kind of monitoring the situation. But no, there's no soldiers out on the streets. You can leave your house freely if you want to. There's no check-ins at the door of your apartment complex, like I know they have some in China. But here they don't have it yet. I'm hoping they don't. So yeah, you can move freely, but they're just asking that you really just try to stay indoors for right now.
Right on. Either of our folks in Canada or African 1884, any presence or evidence of military mobilization, might be preparing to make folks behave and get your toilet paper in an orderly manner?
In Austria, there's no military presence, but they did say that they might be forced to deploy military to support with having supplies delivered to the supermarkets on time in case this situation lingers on for long. And at the same time, also just to deploy them at the border to protect the borders. Otherwise, it's only police, a lot of police presence. And in the parks, if the police see you congregating more than five people, then they just make you disperse. Yeah, so there's no military yet deployed.
Wow, that's the way they've been treating black people publicly, like forever. More than five Negroes present. Probably going to disperse. You got to get out of here. You got a gang being present here. Any of our Canadian representatives, any evidence of military mobilization?
Hi, B from Toronto here. So haven't seen any evidence of military mobilization as of yet. But I'm sure that that is something that has been discussed or in the process of being implemented. Similar to other caller from Canada, there has been an increase of police presence as well. And you're not allowed to go to any conservation areas or parks, be considered trespassing, and you can actually be fined. So it's this is all part of why the state of emergency has been enacted, of which in turn the notwithstanding clause has been enacted at the same time, which is the reason as to why civil liberties have been curbed in response to this coronavirus. But to keep in mind that for Ontario, the provincial government has been wanting to implement this notwithstanding clause even just prior to this whole fiasco. So I'm pretty sure that they're going to maximize the use of that benefit. I leave the line.
Gus, could I just add something?
Yes, sir. Also in Toronto. Canada, sorry.
Yes. I have seen law enforcement, like Toronto police, they are approaching people who are in groups who are not doing the social distancing. So what they're doing, they're just doing like a reminder, can you please disperse and respect the social distancing? So that's the only kind of thing that I've really seen. And then you have a law enforcement officer just reminding citizens that you must respect the social distancing protocols, you know, by keeping a certain distance. So that's the only thing that I've seen. I haven't seen no militarization or, you know, fights or anything that I know of. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'll just mute my line.
Hmm. See there, they should give them the Jermaine Carby treatment. You know, you go up, hey, we told you social distancing. Get down on the ground. Let me see your card. Where's your identification at? You got any warrant? Like, you know, give them. That's the way that they've been treating black people for a long time. Carding, they call it. That's routine procedure. Now, please respect the social distancing. We'd appreciate it if you would disperse. Have a pleasant day. Like, what in the world? Like, come on. Let's see. Other folks who dialed in, think retired firefighter. Did you have a question for any of our folks who dialed in, retired firefighter?
Yes. With this global virus, do anybody thinks that with this virus is going to make the global system of racist white supremacy weaker or stronger? What is anybody's thoughts on the aftermath of this virus, of how the global system of racist white supremacy would probably get more refined? That's it.
Interesting question, or it's questions. So do people think that this pandemic situation will strengthen the system of racism or make it weaker, and then possible refinements of the system as a result of all of this? Let's see. I think we finally got Andrew in the UK with us. Are you with us, sir?
Yeah. Sorry, I'm late, Gus. Can you hear me?
Crystal clear. Good to hear from you. Let's see. I guess if since we have you now, if you want to respond to the first question, and then you can give us any of your observations as well of what has transpired with the virus in your part of the woods, calling in from England. The question again from retired firefighter, do you think what's happening with the so-called coronavirus, do you think it will weaken the system of racism or strengthen it? And then what do you think possible refinements to the system might be as a result of all this? And then, as I said, if you want to add your personal observations, you can do so as well.
Well, first of all, I just want to say that it's great to hear your voice, Gus, and that you know that you're still alive, and
likewise,
and, you know, and it's good to know that retired firefighter is still alive, and you know, because you know your show is needed. You know, it's a very much needed show. I know you've been busy doing your thing, and I get that, but there's been no one stepping into the breach. So it's a needed show. I just want to say that. Okay. So to the questions, how will it strengthen the system of racism and white supremacy? And so what's the first question?
Do you think it will weaken or strengthen the system? That was the first question.
Well, okay. Good question. Because you know, I mean, I've been thinking that as well. I mean, You know, I've been thinking, what is that all about? And in answering, you know, for me to think about that question, I've also had to think of whether or not it was intentional. To you know, whether or not this virus was an intentional creation, or whether or not, you know, the people that run the system of, or try to propagate the system of race and white supremacy, whether or not they're just going to try and take advantage of it. Or you know, is it one or the other? If the virus was pre-made, say by the Americans by the white Americans in a lab somewhere, then that plan needs thinking about. If the virus has just come about by natural means, then how might they take advantage of it? You know. So that, I was thinking about two things. Either way, the virus is there, right? So, I think the thing that comes to my mind here is that people that I've spoken to appear to have taken their eyes off the future, right? So this, I don't know about America, but here there's so much press about this virus that nobody talks about anything else, right? And so for me, when I talk to people, I say to people, think about the future, basically. You know, think about what, you know, how, you know, focus on what it's going to be like when this virus no longer exists. What, you know, don't forget about what you're planning to do, what you've already planned. It seems to me that it's what I was thinking about today is that in the past you'd have Europeans go and practice colonialism or neocolonialism. However, Africa in itself, which is the seat of our self-respect, is the most stable it's ever been, right? We've actually got manufacturing of secondary goods beginning to happen on the continent, right? And actually, at the moment, thank God, the levels of corona is actually quite low on the African continent, right? So you've got stability. That's the one thing you don't want on that continent. A racist cannot afford to have stability amongst Africans, amongst black people, amongst non-white people. So therefore, you need confusion, right? So if you can't get war happening, then you must have disease happening, or at least confusion. You know, in other words, to get the victims thinking about anything other than planning for the future. You can't have victims planning. So for me, the fact that I can't get people to think about the future. I can't get people to think about anything but this. And don't get me wrong, it's serious. You know, you have to safeguard, particularly your elderly relatives. I get that, but to take your eye off the future is dangerous. And planning is one thing that I've seen black people not be very good at for the future. That is, I mean, having a 100-year plan. You know, and so for me, you know, so for me, I think that's the biggest thing that this is doing to us, is getting the victim, getting Africans, getting black people, getting the victims not to think about a world of our making. You know, I think that's dangerous, personally.
Important. Very important, and it's difficult to have that kind of long-range focus, to have a plan, be thinking about the next 100 years, even be thinking about the next 100 days, when everything changes, you know, 10 minutes from 10 minutes to 10 minutes. It's, oh, wait a minute, now we got these restraints. Oh, wait a minute, this is closed, and oh, wait a minute, we contradicted what we said before about that. I mean, when you, everything can be destabilized, it can become very, very difficult to plan, to think, to concentrate, to focus. It can become real, especially when you don't even know if you're gonna have toilet paper. Like, man, and that, I've been saying that the whole time. Racists thrive in those sort of environments where they can have lots of chaos and confusion. Love it.
Gus, can I follow up on that?
Let's get your response to the question from retired firefighter. The question about, is the system of white supremacy, do you think this will strengthen the system, make it weaker?
Yeah, I think, I mean, being that the system is already the dominant system and the racist white supremacists are the most powerful, this will make it stronger in the sense that, in as much as maybe we're not sure if they're the ones who set off this virus, but they're already more or less more prepared to deal with it than we are. You know, so this will make the system stronger. And one thing that the previous caller said, what the system does to us in terms of planning and losing focus, I've been seeing the World Health Organization just telling people to wash their hands, social distancing, and use hand sanitizer. But they don't tell you how to boost your immune system.
That's right.
You know, they don't emphasize that at all completely. They don't tell you what you're going to eat to be able to boost your immune system. So what's happening now, you have Donald Trump talking about chloroquine. This is a drug that was used, that's been used to heal malaria in Africa, in most African countries, and he's trying to promote that drug. So how is the system getting stronger? How are they going to benefit from all this? Like I said, they're much more prepared than we are, the victims of racism and supremacy. So you're going to have the pharmaceutical industries coming in place and being able to provide us with the vaccines and maybe with the medicine that we're going to need to heal ourselves from the coronavirus. So they're not focusing on how you're going to take the right nutrients, to make your immune system very strong. So they're going to distract us so much just to focus on washing our hands and buying the hand sanitizers from them. Thank you. That's all I have to say.
Gus, you mind if I add something to that?
If you could be brief, I want to make sure everyone gets a chance to respond to that question.
I'll be very brief. You know, the thing here, right, is that Africa, because of war in the past, Africa's got a very young population, right? Most black communities worldwide, the populations are actually quite young. Sadly, our elderly people have died of diabetes and high blood pressure, which is not great in itself. This disease kills mostly the elderly. So when you look at the populations of Africa, we're actually quite young. When you look at the infection rate, it's been along a certain temperature, longitude on planet Earth. When you look at the global map, right? So if it's employed to kill us, right, they could have done a lot better, right? You know, they've done very good jobs in the past. This is killing old white people.
Looking at the demographics thus far, we have to keep an eye as this progresses. Let's see. Caller in South Korea. Was that B in Toronto? Was that you?
Yes. Sorry. May I add something real quickly?
Let's hear your response.
Yes, definitely. It's to strengthen white supremacy. A lot of the businesses, ironically, have been thriving throughout this chaos. For the production of more ventilators, they're looking towards the auto industries to work on that, and other technological industries to work on that. And then in terms of the alcohol that's used in the hospitals and for sanitizers and things of that nature, they've been looking towards the alcohol industries or distillery industries in order to supply. So they've actually got a boom out of it, and I'm suspecting that they probably received government contracts of additional fundings for that as well. So in terms of, and those are mainly, again, white owned. So they're definitely getting an advantage out of this. As well as there is, again, that concern with Ontario being under a state of emergency, because, again, it's our civil rights that stands to be eroded, which typically what whites do is they look for these types of opportunities to implement more conservative racist types of protocols. And so I'm suspecting that this is going to happen down the future as well. Thanks, I leave the line.
More rules. Racists generally get excited when they get to make more rules about how they're going to govern the plantation. Caller in South Korea, any thoughts on how this, if this will strengthen or weaken the system of white supremacy?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Let me think. Well, I'll just say this, retired firefighter. I've been to 22 countries in the last 6 years, and I've done a lot of counter-racist observations and experiments. And thanks to the cows, I've been writing a lot of things down. And I can say for sure that the system is not weakening. As far as strengthening, I think it'll become more violent and virulent as their numbers decrease. But no, I don't see a weakening at all. And then I think the ways that they'll refine their white supremacy practices will be that they'll just continue to propagate this notion that all non-white people carry diseases, and, you know, we should do something with the non-white people on Earth. I'll meet my line.
The diseased non-white people, absolutely. Even black people, apparently. They got that rolling as well. Let's see. Henry in Chicago, did you have a question, observation, thought you wanted to share? You should be with us, Henry in Chicago.
All right. Greetings, Gus, and greetings to all the callers and listeners. here in the United States and internationally. Some observations. Illinois had just implemented its stay-at-home ordinance, and there were three reports that I wanted to bring about. There were two parties that were broken up by police yesterday night. One on the north side, which is predominantly a white area, and one on the west side, which is predominantly black, but it's being gentrified right now. So I thought that was pretty interesting. Jackson Park Hospital here in Chicago, in a predominantly black area, they have health workers who are refusing to go in because the hospital is not supplying them with the correct or with the proper kits or equipment to help the patients. Matter of fact, they don't even have They don't even have enough masks. And so now these workers who are predominantly black in this hospital are refusing to go in. So I don't know if they lost their jobs or anything like that, but it's one of the only people right now who are allowed to go to work in regards to the medical field. And just my observation, I have noticed, I didn't notice a military presence, but I've noticed Illinois state troopers on side streets now. Typically here, Illinois state troopers are on the express and highways, but I see them now on residential areas now more and more. So I don't know if something is coming or not, but that's basically what I've observed so far. But that's all I have under my line.
Much obliged for that, Henry, in Chicago. That is striking, because you normally do not see state troopers like in the neighborhood. Like, that is highly irregular in my experience. Let's see. Let me finish that email from our caller in China, and then we can get other folks. All right, so I'm at the halfway point. Caller in China. What is COVID-19? It's dangerous, and why is it particularly dangerous for black people in America? As you already know, COVID-19 is a zoonotic virus, simply meaning a virus that can pass from animal to human. In this case, it is believed that it was born out of wet market in Wuhan from bats being cross-contaminated with pigs. Basically, if anyone is familiar with Gordon Ramsay's Kitchen Nightmares shows, in which constantly curses out restaurant owners for cross-contamination in their freezers, this is what happened. And it is made worse by the fact that there was no refrigeration. The virus creates a particularly aggressive type of pneumonia that can be lethal, but typically does not kill those who receive appropriate care after diagnosis and treatment. In a dangerous escalation, COVID-19 has now two variants after mutation, and possibly more, COVID-19L and COVID-19S. L is what mostly existed in Wuhan and throughout China, but COVID-S is what you see in Italy, which has already had more deaths than the home of the virus, China. This is a direct result of the mutation, and in America, because of the government's terrible response, it is likely to mutate in America to a much stronger virus. This is what scares me most. People often talk about how non-lethal the virus is, but what many don't know, partly because the government has failed to explain, that COVID-19S causes permanent lung damage. You can escape death, but you will likely have a harder time breathing for the rest of your life in a white supremacist world that has created a planet with less CO2 than any time in the history of mankind. White supremacy has created a world of global warming that threatens the oxygen levels, also created a world of super viruses that strangely attacks the respiratory systems. Take that how you want, I'm just saying. Why is it particularly dangerous for black people in America? One thing that helped China more than anything else besides the quarantines was the timing of the outbreak. February in China marks the beginning of the Spring Festival. This is the largest migration of human beings on the planet, far outdoing the Hajj to Mecca. This migration is also unique in its type of location. Most Chinese are only a generation away from poverty, and many of its people do seasonal jobs in other cities. So when the Spring Festival begins, most people return to their grandparents' homes, towns, which are easily over 90% of the time the countryside. The countryside, as you would assume, is a place with clean air, less pollution, and spacious. Exactly the polar opposite of Chinese megacities where most people live, hence the massive drop in the spreading of the COVID-19. Unfortunately, Americans, by and large, have no such oasis of natural earth to escape to. Thank white supremacy for that. This is another reason Africa has not been overrun with the virus. Less massive city centers to spread the virus. Sadly, many of our people will find social distancing difficult to do by proximity, and that helps put us at risk. More so than those in the rural towns that are generally compromised of white people. Also, the American government responded so late to the outbreak that the spread of the virus by more hosts could, and I say will, increase the possibility of the further mutation of COVID-19. Mutation will make the virus increasingly more powerful and harder to treat with standard or even enhanced antibiotic treatment. Another danger is that, unfortunately, many black people do not have good dietary habits. Of course, another real-life effect of white supremacy. We just talked about that. This virus loves those with poor eating habits, obesity, and asthma, which is something that particularly affects black people in America. Another particularly dangerous exposure is from the elderly, which many are in concentrated nursing homes, as we know. Many black women and men are employed by nursing homes across the country. These factors put us at higher risk than others, so as usual, we need to do work harder than others and take more precautions to save our lives. How to protect yourself from COVID-19 for black people? Stay inside as much as possible. Spend this time getting reacquainted with your family. Spend this time reading. Heard that before? Reading is more important than watching television. Not watching television, which at this time can only serve as a stressor. Spend this time learning a new skill. During the month of quarantining, I got a very good foundation of Python programming. Or planning a diet that is more or completely plant-based. My God! What moron talks like that? On the issue of social distancing, this is white people's way of saying quarantine. Of course, it's America's, and white folks don't take too kindly to government suggestions, whether good or not, so they did word salad and named quarantining social distancing. Regardless of the term, it's best to stay put as much as possible. Exercise more. If you're at home, there is no excuse to not get a few minutes of exercise in at minimum. Absolutely. Wash your hands. Not with alcohol-based hand sanitizers. COVID-19S can still live on the hands after using it. Soap is most effective. My goodness. Now, we had all those jokes, the caller in New Jersey. Hey, man, soap is packed up to the ceilings. They are selling out of toilet paper and guns and ammunition and everything else. Soap is stacked up by the barrel. Can't give it away. Wash your hands with soap. Instead of buying toilet paper, never understood that, people in China are laughing about it. Buy bars of soap instead. As I remember, it is an effective antibacterial soap. Wash your hands thoroughly after going outdoors because we often touch our faces, and this is the number one way to contract the virus. To dap or don't dap. Forget all that. No touching. Don't know handshaking, no dapping, no let me get a hug. As hard as it might be for some, it is a must. The virus loves hands and faces. No need to share yours at this moment. Blah, 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 blah. Almost messed up. He gave his phone number out. Almost kept reading. Okay. I think I read everything that was supposed to go out publicly. Wash your hands. Plant-based diet. Wash your hands. And yeah, social distancing. I would have a lot of questions for him because he was in China going through the quarantine measures. But this is our listener in China. He said he would be down to see if he can coordinate. It's such a big time difference. It's 17. Our caller in South Korea, too, is such a big time difference with those countries because it's like Monday there already. It's hard to coordinate, but we'll see if we can get him on for a live broadcast. Did any of our international folks have other observations, comments that they wanted to make sure they got in?
Cannot be heard.
Let's see. I heard multiple folks. Let's see. Caller in South Korea. You want to go first?
Yeah, I just want to say that the diet is really important, and the cows has been helping me with my vegan diet. Rest in peace to Layla Africa. I just found out that he has transitioned. So I think today I'll make a special effort just to really just eat vegan and really just focus on my diet. And I'll do this day every year in remembrance of him. I'll meet my line.
Oh, Dr. Layla Africa, guest on the Cavs. He was with us on Tacky Super Bowl Sunday. Did he pass away like today?
Yeah, Gus, I'm just looking at this right now on Tariq Nasheed's Instagram. He just posted it.
Wow, that is horrible. That is horrible. Layla Africa did a lot when Gus T Renegade was tubby and eating potato chips. He was doing a lot, saying exactly what a lot of folks have said today. Diet is super important. If you want to preserve your immune system, diet is super important. He's written so many books talking about this and correct things to eat and ways to preserve your body and take care of yourself. Right on the Cavs and the archives. You can go back February 2011. He was right with us. That is horrendous news, Dr. Layla Africa. Check out some of his, if you got time to sit around, you don't want to watch nonsense, you can check out some of his YouTube videos. He has lots, and I mean lots, of really constructive information that could probably be of benefit now.
Hey, more Gus, could I add?
Yes, sir.
Oh, sorry, sir. You put the question that will this coronavirus situation make the system of white supremacy racism stronger. I think that it ultimately will, because as long as non-white people are being mistreated and confused, it makes the system stronger. But being here on the Cavs and us talking about the things that we're going through, and we're sharing our experiences, and we're sharing, the suffering that we go through on this planet for being non-white people, that is supposed to help us learn how to be problem solvers instead of problem makers. So I guess that is one positive effect of us being together here in the Cavs. So I'm really thankful that I'm had the opportunity to participate in the Cavs and to hear people's experiences from all over the world. And I'll meet my line.
Hey, we are grateful. I'm sure a lot of listeners, because I know a lot of folks, like I said, they fussed at Gus T quite a bit when the Global Sunday Talk was not on. So they definitely appreciate being able to hear all of the different viewpoints and suggestions from folks who are around the world. That's what we should be doing, exchanging views and trying to get a better understanding, especially in moments like these. Any of our other international folks have comments, suggestions they want to make sure they get in?
Hello, Gus.
Andrew in England. Yes, sir.
Yeah, I've been thinking about the question a bit more, and I think it could go either way. I think it could strengthen the system if we don't think about how we want the world to be after this thing is blown away. You know, I mean, you know, and that's, you know, that's our choice, you know. I honestly do believe that the idea is to create a sort of a apocalyptic thing, you know. One of these nemesis that everybody really focuses on. So for example, you've got the Grenfell Tower inquiry going on in the background in the UK. It's not been in the news for the last 2 weeks. It's not been in the news. The inquiry about, we've had the inquiry about the fire service, you know, about the fire engines and the firemen and all of that. But now it's the inquiry into the people that built the tower. But yet no one's talking about it. Everybody's talking about COVID-19. So we've got to be careful to focus on the things that are important to our development after this. you know, so if we don't do that, I think it would have served its purpose for the people that, you know, for the racists. That's really what I'm trying to say.
Excellent point, Andrew. Some of the other folks dialed in, I want to make sure I don't miss them as well. And we spent all that time talking about the Grenfell Tower. That was so important. You had all those non-white people who died in the fire and were racially displaced. I'd said that where you have important things like that where it gets totally displaced. If you check the newspaper, maybe that'll be on page, you know, D51. And the first 50 pages are all coronavirus, COVID, came from China. What are we going to do? Not that that's, you know, not important, but just a whole lot of important things can get totally displaced, forgotten. Racism, white supremacy is extremely skillful at that sort of tactic. The caller on, I guess you're on the Skype line. Caller on the Skype line, did you have commentary, observations?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah. Steve, I here in the UK.
Oh, grand. Awesome.
I just wanted to... I was just looking through Layla's book here, thinking about how much of a good candidate it is for a book study, African Holistic Health by Layla Africa. And I just wanted to read a little bit. Can you still hear me?
Crystal clear, sir. Crystal clear.
Okay, I'll just read this. It's from 328, page 328. The rampant paranoia about catching colds, viruses, bacterial infections, and diseases is organized ignorance. Vaccinationists, I think, and drug peddlers stimulate, create, recreate, and manufacture this germ theory, paranoia, to sell mouthwashes, antihistamines for the nose, disinfectant sprays, douche solutions, feminine hygiene sprays, deodorants, antibiotics, bottle sterilizers, eye washes, soaps, toothpaste and foot sprays. This massive paranoia leads one to live in a fear of an attack from a predatory diseased bacteria. Bacteria reside in the body at all times. An imbalance of bacteria is caused by disease. Bacteria do not cause disease. They react to disease. And if we could just read another paragraph, it's from a page on 332, I think it is. Yeah. If the paranoia of the evil bacteria myth fails to manipulate the public, then an evil dead cell particle virus myth is blamed for causing a disease. Virus means poison. Consequently, arsenic is a virus. DDT is a virus. Vaccines are viruses. Penicillin and all drugs are viruses. It is medically defined as dead as well as living and can spread disease. Whenever a germ or bacteria cannot be blamed for the cause of a disease, a virus is recruited to be the cause. A virus can be in one system and not cause a disease, and at the same time is believed to cause the disease. And it goes on. This book is great because it provides a lot of context about the development of medical history, which would inform a lot of this discussion, and hopefully that gives us something to think about. As for strengthening white supremacy, I think this event will be used to do that. I'll mute my line.
Much obliged for the reading. Say it again, reading is more important than watching television. And Dr. Layla Africa was a pretty prolific author. Nutricide, like he wrote lots of, you know, books of... talking about the same subject matter, things we can do to bolster our immune system and health as best we can. African Holistic Health. That was the book you were just reading from, right? Maybe he muted his line. African Holistic Health. I think that was the book he was just reading from. Nutricide. African Health Secrets, Natural Health for African Americans. Like, he, prolific author. Reading is more important than watching television. Africa for Global Health Governance. It's Africa and Global Health Governance. Lots of works that he has. It was African Holistic. African Holistic Health, that was the book you were reading from?
Yeah, you're correct, yeah.
Yeah.
I definitely think we should do it as a book study, but it's a long read.
Probably worth it. I'll have to check out. I'm sure he has one that is, appropriate length that we wouldn't have to spend, the whole year reading
it. Yeah, maybe Nutricide would be a better candidate because it does cover the same subject matter, but the good thing about African Holistic Health, it does offer a lot of solutions and a deep understanding and
yeah,
and look at the medical history.
Man. Layla Africa. I said that yesterday. Some of the folks that it would be good to have around for all of this. Layla Africa, Dr. Francis Cress Welsing, black people who have a understanding of white supremacy, racism, and medicine would be grand to get their perspective, help us kind of get some logic on all of this. Let's see. I'm so glad we were able to get you in on the call, sir. Make sure we didn't miss anybody. Oh, our caller. I think we have another Florida person. We've had lots of Florida representation the last few days. Our caller in Florida, did you have a question, comment?
Hello, all. I have two questions, and they are, is there anyone in any of the locations that has had the misfortune of knowing someone personally who has tested and tested positive for the coronavirus COVID-19? And secondly, is there any sense internationally, especially in South Korea or if you have a caller in another Asian country, that has a sense of the government or citizen reaction to the U.S. president taking the stance of positioning this firmly as a virus? As a Chinese virus, is there any sense of how people feel about that, or is that a non-issue? And I will mute my mic.
Great questions. So I guess we can do this one the easy way, and then people can take time on the latter on, Trump saying this is the Chinese virus. How do people feel about that in your respective parts of the world? But so let's see. We'll just stay silent. Maybe if the answer is no, nobody knows anybody, we can just have silent, and there you go. So does anybody know someone who has the virus, COVID-19, novel coronavirus? Does anybody, somebody who has contracted, tested positive for the virus? All right, so we have no. So the other question was Donald Trump, him coming out and, it's the Chinese virus. It came from China. How is that being received in different parts of the world? Are people upset about that? Do they agree? Do they care? folks, our international folks, do you have a response to that one?
In Austria, to be honest, I think folks don't really care. Reason being because there've also been some overt racist white supremacist attack on so-called Asian Chinese people on the trains, in restaurants. But, so when Trump said that, I didn't hear any pushback from this end, And like I said, there've been attacks on Chinese people,
All right, that's Austria, African 1884 with Austria. They don't really care. They've been attacking Chinese people there anyway. So, all right, that's one. Caller in South Korea, our callers in Canada, Andrew's in London, or I guess now we have two people calling from the UK. President Trump, do folks care in your area? Or?
The general sentiment in South Korea is that, of course, I haven't been able to interact with any Koreans face to face, but from what I can see online, they don't appreciate President Trump referring to the virus as, you know, from China or from Asia. But that's all I can really tell right now because I haven't had much human contact. I'll be my line.
Okay.
Hi, this is B from Toronto.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So, in terms of any reactions to Trump calling it a Chinese virus, there has been some debate in the media regarding that, and it has been stated from the media and from others that it shouldn't be considered a quote-unquote Chinese virus, as it's discriminatory, and they've now have the term anti-Chinese racism in some of their articles as well. From like at this point, for me, it's neither here nor there. It came from China. You know, I'm sure that if it came from somewhere else, they would have labeled it somewhere else, something else. Or I'm actually surprised that they're not, you know, labeling it now Chinese and an Italian virus because Italy is being hit pretty hard. But again, it's not surprising. It's to be expected. If it's being attributed to a non-white population, they're going to call it a particular virus according to that population, like how they consider Ebola as an African virus, even though Africa is a continent. So it's not surprising. I'm still waiting for, you know, when it's going to become a pale man's virus or a white virus or, you know, a virus from a European country, as there are much more diseases with among the recessive genes than in non-white populations. But I leave the line.
Much obliged to be in Toronto. Our other caller in Canada, Andrew, our other caller in the UK, any thoughts on the Chinese virus, how that's being received in your area?
Sorry, Gus, this is Andrew.
Yes, sir.
Well, there is a white virus that's called paedophilia. Mm-hmm. And they run around all over Africa feeling up children. And that's a fact. That's a white virus. And it was in Greece and it was in Rome. And it's on their artwork. I studied it at art college as a white virus, as far as I can see. And everybody else, sorry, some people participate in that or catch it. It's the truth. In terms of how Asian people or what Trump said and how the whole thing about what he said about it being a Asian or Chinese virus or whatever. So some people get into that terminology because they're already racist. You know, some white people, you know, they love all that here because they're racist. So initially you had some Asian looking people getting attacked. You know, it was on, you know, a few attacks, it was on TV here, and you know, being called names and this kind of thing. You know, you're always going to get racists and other ignorant people doing that. But as the previous, I didn't catch your name, but you know, in Europe anyway, it's mainly in Italy right about now. But this country apparently is only a week or 2 weeks behind Italy in terms of numbers because Boris Johnson, his lack of action meant that you're going to see huge numbers rising here. But then someone like Boris Johnson is who's Donald Trump's mate, you know, he encourages that kind of racism in this country. So people did get in and ask the question. People did get into the whole Donald Trump here, you know, Donald Trump's nonsense in terms of what he says because they're already racist. But I think the majority, I think it's kind of been forgotten when people look at Spain and Italy. And the fact it's not in Africa. You know, the fact, you know, it's a silent conversation not being had on TV. Why are the numbers so low in Africa? Why? It's not the conversations. No one's having that conversation in the UK.
Good point. Good point. We should have had representation from the continent. Had Cal's listener, I forgot the country he emailed in. It was related. It was not COVID related. It was not COVID related. But he was asking for seeking recommendations on dealing with racism, tragic arrangements, that sort of thing, confused victims. We should have had next time should have had representation from the continent. Any of the other folks from? Yes, sir.
Caller. Gus, could
yes,
I
sir.
Ask?
Yes, sir.
Well, in terms of Donald Trump's use of calling it the Chinese virus, Thomas from New York, like we have another, the Cause has another show that we have on Saturdays, the compensatory call-in. So. A gentleman, Thomas from New York, was talking about Trump's use of the Chinese virus. And I just wanted to add to that, here in Canada, well, I think between Trump and Justin Trudeau, Trump is more of a raw kind of practicer of racist. Like, Justin Trudeau is more of a refined racist. So, when he was talking about, when it first started to come out that the COVID virus was coming out and it was coined as being a Chinese virus, he would say that he didn't want people to discriminate against each other. But knowing, because we're living in a system of white supremacy racism, just this whole thing could just be just another excuse to mistreat non-white people from all over the world, including people who are yellow, black, yellow, pale, and people who are Asian, people who are black, which I just want to make clear, non-white people. So want to make sure that I'm using the correct words, but generally harming non-white people. So what I was saying again, it's more of a refined racism that Trudeau was more or less practicing, and then Donald Trump is more of practicing a more raw, blunt, direct racism. So I don't know if that answered the question.
Mr. Trudeau.
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir. Caller in South Korea. Yes, sir.
Okay. Yeah, I just wanted to say, just observing Trump's calling this the Chinese virus just really shows me, like you say all the time, Gus, how whites weaponize language and how whites weaponize words, and especially the use of colors. I think Europe had a big plague like in the 1300s, and they called it like the Black Death or the Black Plague. And they called it that because it came from the Black Sea, but I've never seen a Black Sea. It's just really interesting how whites weaponize their language all the time.
Absolutely. They know the power of words in a system of racism, white supremacy. That is the dominant motivating fact. And in fact, they're using the language of war. President Trump has been saying, I'm a wartime president. We got to get on wartime footing. Those are the type of metaphors that they've been using and talking about this disease. So it's wartime footing. I'm a wartime president. We got to deal with the Chinese virus. Almost just with their languaging. We're at war with China. We're at war with China. We're at war with this virus. This Chinese virus. It came from China. We're at war. That's just the languaging that they're using. Now, imagine that. Or just pay attention to how that evolves, particularly if this lasts. People have to stay cooped up and frustrated and worried and don't know if they're going to be able to pay their bills and such. If that stretches on and you have that sort of languaging, system of racism, white supremacy. Very easy to do the math on that. Any other folks? Comments, observations, questions. This is not supposed to be our 3-hour broadcast. It's supposed to be shorter, but I do recognize this is pretty historic times that we are in. We will make sure we get our Global Sunday Talk back on the air. It's supposed to be every third. This is not even the day it's supposed to be on. It's supposed to be the third Sunday of the month. It's supposed to have been last week, but this has probably worked out fine. We should be back regularly so that we can hopefully have more folks. We can have some folks from the continent in to kind of discuss as this evolves. What are we seeing? Historic times, as I said. Any other folks, questions, comments they want to make sure they get in?
Greetings, Gus. I had one other question. Do any of the international folks have any concerns about their employment or any of their friends? To me, one of the concerns I have is that, you know, what's going to happen a month from now, 2 months from now in terms of job loss?
Excellent question.
Hi.
Be in Toronto. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, sorry. Sorry to interrupt. Thank you, Gus. Yes, I know of an individual who is currently stuck in Guyana, trying to get a flight back to Canada. Employment is definitely a concern because a friend has been stranded for a week beyond the destination date they were to return. Also, the employment insurance in Ontario has flooded with 500,000 applying, and it's scheduled to increase further as more layoffs occur. In terms of the service industry and hospitality, included into that service industry has been hit pretty hard as a result, with people not being able to continue work. In some situations, some companies are suggesting laying off their workers as opposed to keeping them off, even though there's wage subsidy programs to help keep them on. And that way, the employers do not have to pay for any additional benefits if that's inclusive as part of their job description. And many people working from home with their companies calling to make sure that they're indeed working from home and fulfilling their job duties, although modified considering the situation. Thanks, and I'll leave the line.
Wow. I'm not surprised about that at all. I know, I think it was African 1884 in Austria. He had commented at first about them contemplating the same thing, like, we should just fire the workers. Then we don't have to pay them or their benefits while this lasts. And then we can just rehire everybody after all this is over with. He said that I guess some of the upper management gave some pushback, so they decided not to do that. But yeah, I suspect it's a whole lot of job anxiety. Any other folks want to respond to that one? Job anxieties?
Can I be heard?
Yes, sir. Caller in South Korea.
Okay. There's a lot of job anxiety right now amongst the English teachers. There's two main ways to work as an English teacher in South Korea. Number one, you can work for the government as a public school teacher. Number two, you can work for a hagwon or an after-school private academy. If you're working right now for a public school, your salary is fine. You're still being paid. Most of the teachers just need to make a lesson plan from home and submit that to show that they're working from home. However, if you're working for a private hagwon, some schools are not paying their teachers any money. Some schools are paying their teachers 70% of their salary. And then some schools are paying their teachers all of their salary. Coincidentally, my contract ended on February 29th, and this virus started around February 19th. So there were some days that I didn't get paid. I didn't feel like arguing about it with my school, so I just ended the contract, and also had to move to a new apartment during this viral outbreak. So if you think moving is hard, you should try moving in a foreign country. And if you think moving in a foreign country is hard, you should try moving in a foreign country during a viral outbreak. it was really traumatizing, but I got it done. I'm in a new apartment with plants and vegetables and a good view, so I'm happy. Right now, I'm just saving my coins. Luckily, I had a lot of savings, so I'm just waiting until this passes to find a new job at a new school.
Wow. I cannot even imagine moving in a foreign country in the middle of a viral apocalypse. Wow. And you're a black person in a system of white supremacy racism. Like, if you think you are not going to get any help moving things before, woof, man, oh man, oh man. I hope you got some super relaxation time and detoxification and self-care. Like, wow. Yeah, I can't even imagine. I can't even imagine. Anybody else have comments, responses they wanted to get in about the job anxieties where you are?
Gus, can I add something to what I said previously?
African 1884 in Austria, they were contemplating firing you and your coworkers.
Exactly. You know, so again, they didn't want to spend the money during this whole period where we're being told to quarantine ourselves at home, you know. And just to provide some context too, I think this, the job anxiety is also going to affect, or it's going to impact also people that are self-employed. I mentioned that briefly before. Here you have Africans who have small businesses here. They have supermarkets. Some of them are running barbershops. Some of them have restaurants. Many of them employ Africans that they don't register with the social system, and they pay them under the table, for a better word. So what's going to happen now is that they can't even go to the state, because the state had promised to say, they promised to provide some support to small businesses. So most of the Africans can't even go to the state and say that they have this number of employees with them and that they'd like some kind of subsidy from the state. You know, so this whole thing is going to affect us so much. People were employed and people were self-employed at the same time. And I think it's a learning, you know, and I don't have any solution, but, you know, myself, like I said, I'm glad that I'm secure for this whole year and everything. And let's see what's going to happen next year. Because we were told at work that the whole quarantine could last until July 2020. So I'm just hoping for the best.
That is lots and lots of us worldwide. That man, oh man, people who are self-employed on Neutralizing Workplace Racism every Thursday. I have said for years, if you are a black person, so-called entrepreneur, you work for yourself, as they say. That doesn't mean you don't have to deal with racism, white supremacy. That will not solve your problems. It may change or make it easier, may minimize some aspects of white supremacy, racism, but the problem will still be there. Wow. You talk about the amount of influence that a racist can have on your business, even if you are a black entrepreneur. Wow. More to come. I'm sure that will come up in Neutralizing Workplace Racism, but worldwide, black entrepreneurs, they had a whole segment on that I was just listening to, where they were talking to entrepreneurs who said overnight they are unemployed and have no business, and it may not change for a while given all of this. Like, that is the system of white supremacy racism, and don't even know if they're going to be if they will be included in all these, you know, $1 trillion bailouts and things that they're talking about. Might not even be for so-called small businesses.
Exactly. Thank you.
Lots to discuss. Did we miss anyone? Anybody comment they wanted to make sure they get in? Grand. We didn't miss anybody. Everybody satisfied. No questions, comments. We will have much more time to investigate, explore all of this, especially as it continues to evolve. It looks like, you know, at least for the next few days or so, this is not going to change unless things worsen, which you hope will not be the case anywhere in the world. But not only will we be here tomorrow, we should have a white woman on the program, author of the book The Poisoned City, talking about the Flint water crisis and even how that has been altered as a result of what happened right now. We'll have other programs. I'll update the Facebook page and what have you, so you'll be able to know we're going to be broadcasting live. The book club continues this Thursday, workplace racism on Friday, compensatory call-in this coming Saturday. As I said, we'll be trying to broadcast more since, you know, the epidemic. We got a lot of folks who are at home and dealing with this as best they can, which is sounds like everybody around the world. I didn't hear anybody who said that they think this situation is going to weaken the system of white supremacy. That is not my thought, my understanding at all. As I say, anytime racists have an excuse to wheel out their tanks and have more white people with guns patrolling, walking around, and authorized to use force, I always think that is a win for the system of racism, white supremacy. That in no way to me signals a weakening of the system. When they get to go and crank up the tanks, oh yeah, it is good times on the plantation. My man who did Planet of the Apes, they got Viral Apocalypse in Planet of the Apes too. In Planet of the Apes, the guy who did the original series, the one that came out in the 60s and all, he said he was a Vietnam veteran, and he said he loved the sting of battle, the napalm and the shooting and the smell of blood. Ah, I miss it so. You got a lot of individuals classified as white. That is how they think. That is exactly why in this response, that's what they're called. This is wartime response. We got to run towards the bullets. Wartime president. We have an enemy. That's the way they watch the movie Patton. Folks that are messing around and you're on Netflix all day long, Patton, excellent movie to watch if you want to understand what it means to be white. That military response, because that's what you're seeing right now. Patton, check it out. You can, in fact, you could probably just watch the first hour or so and you'll get a good flavor. It is like 3 hours. It's a pretty good movie. But yeah, you got free time. That can be one. And then you can do some reading and all the rest of it. I am so grateful for all of the folks spending some of their time stateside, internationally. You could have been doing lots of other things. You could have been getting water. You could have been making hand sanitizer, cleaning your residence, trying to prepare a lesson plan for your children if they're not going to be in school. Lots of other critical life-saving things. So hopefully you got some constructive information and this was worth your time and energy to hang out. Appreciate our caller in South Korea missing some sleep. Man, rest is super important. Protect your immune system. Rest is super important. Thank you so much for getting up a little bit early to hang out and share some of your views, what's happening down in South Korea. Thanks to all of our international callers. So appreciative for you all being with us this Sunday, Monday, technically, for South Korea. We'll look forward to doing this again, checking in, seeing what everybody is observing, doing, suggestions. Repeat what Andrew said. This is serious. Take it seriously. This is serious. But let's not lose sight of our plans and other things that are happening on the planet. Racist white supremacists are definitely doing other things on the planet, whether that is concealing what happened with the Grenfell fire or lots of other things, raping small children. Lots of other things are happening, organizing their tanks and what have you. They have lots of plans beyond just the coronavirus. We should be having other plans, and the ultimate plan of replacing white supremacy with justice, that should not be lost in the midst of all this. You got some of that free time where nothing's happening. You've washed your hands for the 100th time that day and got everything straight while you're doing your self-quarantine. Put some time and energy on the problem, replacing white supremacy with justice. And you can certainly put some time and energy checking out, maybe watching a video, getting some information on Dr. Layla Africa. I'll make sure to post his visit back in 2011 to the COW.S. But wow, that is super devastating to hear of his transition. Prolific author, attempted counter-racist scientist. Lots of constructive information that he left us that I think we could benefit from checking out. Dr. Layla Africa definitely will be missed. Certainly appreciate all of his life efforts, time, and energy towards solving the problem. Much more to come. Drop an email if you have any questions or need additional information. UntilJustice@gmail.com. UntilJustice@gmail.com. With that, I'll be prepping for our broadcast tomorrow. Take excellent care, whatever you deem to be safe, to protect yourself, people you care about, family, offspring. Get lots of rest. Eat well. Eat to nourish. Dr. Layla Africa talks about that a lot. Eat to nourish yourself. Bolster that immune system. Get some fresh fruits and veggies if you can. Be really mindful about what you're eating. Taking this time to prepare your own food. That right there can go a long way. You're at home. You have no reason. If you're working from home, no reason to not be well rested. It's not that much Netflix binging needed. Get quality rest so you can take care of yourself in these really stressful days. With that, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. Let's take care of our brain computer. We will need to do a lot of high-powered thinking. Man. In addition to being sober, let's be buckled up. Shouldn't be too much traveling, but if you do go out, buckle up every time, driver or passenger. In addition to being sober, buckled, if you are driving, you are not on the phone, particularly with these days. Folks are talking about military mobilization and state troopers are hanging out in the neighborhood now. With all of this uncertainty, you do not want any reason for race soldiers, badge or no, to stop you and ask you any questions. I saw you on that. None of that. Let's try and minimize that as much as possible. It should be in the forefront of our mind daily. The system of racism, white supremacy is war against non-white people. That should be very glaring in these days. Our behavior should reflect that. Every time we step out of the house, those should be limited opportunities now, but every time we step out, that should be reflected in our conduct. With that, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cow signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
your
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.